Good afternoon. My name is Christian Moore. I'm a fourth-year undergraduate in landscape architecture, and I use the art of the travel to the Netherlands this past June. The Netherlands is a nation-scale landscape machine. Endowed with rich delta soil at the mouth of the Rhine, the landscape of the Netherlands is equal parts man-made and nature, constructed to maximize agricultural production, trade, and settlement. My trip was an investigation of the workings of this machine, its component parts, its inputs and outputs, and the resulting cultural landscape that neither man nor nature could have predicted. To begin, here are the two terms that have informed my study. Landscape machine, derived from an essay by Jane Amidon. A result of integrated ecological and man-made systems, the landscape machine enables human industry while blurring the distinction between the natural and the technological. Holder, a body of land reclaimed from the sea, typically surrounded by dikes, threaded with canals, and drained by windmills or modern electric pumps. They have an intrinsic and ultimately fatal tendency to sink. Holders are the nuclear unit of the Dutch landscape machine. I traveled light. A backpack with clothes, a tent, my sketchbook, and a rented single-speed bicycle that I wore out not once, but twice. In 3 weeks, I made a loop around the country, seeing an astonishing variety of landscape types, enjoying numerous conversations with locals, and collecting sketches of the Dutch landscape machine. Following are some of my findings, which I will take you through, sketch by sketch. Kinderdijk was a powerful introduction to the most iconic members that we all know of the Dutch landscape. Dutch windmills are meticulously crafted to harness polar winds, pumping water short distances uphill. Mostly antiquated now, they were closely monitored so as not to pump too fast and cause polar lands to sink, nor too slow and risk flooding. Predating the windmills, turps, which are mounds of soil dumped from canals, were an early solution to keep homes and churches dry when the fields flooded. They're hidden in plain sight, and it took me 2 days of searching to find one, finally, in the village of Vines. Only the church and cemetery sit on the Vines turf, but a bustling hamlet of 180 souls surrounds, connected to the city of Leeuwarden by the Dokkumer Egea Canal, which sits several feet above the surrounding landscape. In Rotterdam, the mechanical members of port activity can be found. Monster-like, these machines were used for loading grain, for moving bulk goods, and raising and lowering flood defenses. The component on the left was the first installment of the Dutch Deltaverken, a mammoth engineered regulation of the Rhine-North Sea interface that spans the entire southwest of the country. The Afsnitdijk protects the heart of the Netherlands, regulating the movements of people, water, and sediment between the interior IJsselmeer and the North Sea. It's only 18 miles long, but took several hours to bike across, given the limits of my single-speed bicycle and the absurdly strong headwind. The Afsnitdijk made numerous large-scale land reclamations possible, as you'll see soon, and is the final line of defense before the North Sea. In a meeting I had with Professor Inge Bolbink of TU Delft, she described the peculiar nature of the Dutch landscape. It's an inverted landscape. The rivers are higher than the surrounding land, and a vast webbing of dikes keeps everything relatively dry. You can think of it this way. The Dutch lowlands are like a series of bowls all next to each other. The rivers run along the rims of the bowls, and down below is where your cities and your agriculture occurs. So it's a little disorienting coming from the United States when you're in a field and you look up and you see boats sailing through the farm fields. It's very disorienting and fascinating place. It was also very evident in the Flevolholder, which sits 18 feet below sea level. A new landscape without the trappings of the old world, the Flevolholder is populated with some of the largest wind turbines in Europe. Scant tree rows and vast fields leave the traveler feeling very exposed. It's an uncomfortable landscape, and the wind always blows. There's something disconcerting knowing the water of the world's oceans is somewhere above you. Wind is not the only flow in the Dutch landscape machine. Water, of course, but also the many modes of transportation, including the swarms of bikes. These small sketches study the careful craft of the bridges, roundabouts, and windmills that channel these flows. The central drawing is a double roundabout. With vehicles above, the sunken center is used for bicycle traffic. The The Nederlandse-Spoorwegen rail network is the connective transportation tissue of the Dutch machine. Rotterdam Centraal is a fine example of new capital investment in this system, designed in part by the landscape firm Westate, who was here last night. Sleek and metallic, the building looks and is a piece of machinery, and the font lifted from the 1950s-era station reinforces the aesthetic. North of Rotterdam is the nursery capital of the world, Boskoop. Crisscrossed by hundreds of canals, the city is partitioned by several hundred nurseries, each with a horticultural specialty. Arno and Nico Reinbeek were kind enough to show me their facility, which maximizes every inch of space on their thin slice of turf. When a neighboring nursery goes under, competition is fierce in Boskoop. The enterprising will colonize the vacant lot using ingenious rotating bridges to connect across the canals. Given the precarious state of the subsiding land, no heavy machinery can be used. Everything in Boskoop is still done by hand. Subsidence and saltwater represent entropy in the Dutch landscape machine, each working to sink, swamp, or salinize the land, restricting use. On the island of Texel, scientists are testing crop resistance to salt, producing varieties of lettuce, potato, and cabbage that can be grown in the Netherlands, as well as other salty delta countries like Pakistan and Bangladesh. The farm's salt ponds double as habitat for many birds, including the exotic Egyptian goose, which you can see peeking out in the top left there. In the bottom right, you see two water towers from the coastal city of Den Helder. Even in the water-rich Netherlands, fresh water is a treasured resource. In addition to the salt farm, there are other active innovators in the machine. The 21 Dutch water authorities work quietly to ensure the landscape machine continues smooth operations. I met with Eric Kindersma of Waterschap Rivierenland, the authority responsible for the land between Nijmegen on the German border and Kinderdijk. I spent part of an afternoon with him in his office, and he explained the setup of the water authorities as governmental, but intentionally kept separate from politics, so that politicking doesn't mess up the process of long-range planning. Still, politicking represents a significant danger to the work of Eric and other members of these authorities, and, left unchecked, could lead to their and the machine's eventual undoing. Back in Amsterdam, the workings of people in the landscape are evident in the Amsterdamse Bos, an urban forest with soaring poplars and formal rows of linden south of the city. The regimented trees frame the messy forest and canal ecologies. Originally planted by people, these ecologies have since organized themselves with various vegetative strata and a profusion of botanical diversity. The Bos embodies a recurring theme of the machine: people frame and nature fills in the gaps with an abundance of life. A few miles from the Bos, we see how inhabitants frame their homes within the landscape machine. Clipped grass, espalier linden trees, focal tree plantings, and wooden reinforced retaining walls separate the homestead from the canals and the surrounding pasture. It's a landscape binary that requires significant effort to maintain. Many houses don't occupy such bento box compartments, but blend into and embody the messiness of the landscape. Remnant ornamentation from past eras still defines much of the building stock in the older Dutch cities. In the earlier years of the landscape machine, ornamentation, especially of the windmills, was equally prevalent. The stylistic and formal relationship between buildings and components of the landscape machine is strong. The sleek modern turbines of the Flevopolder have an analog in the sleek modern architecture of downtown Rotterdam. Beyond ornament, the Dutch landscape machine has both inspired and been inspired by modernism and the Dutch de Stijl movement, which coincidentally celebrated its centennial this year. I spent 2 days studying the gardens of the mid-century Dutch landscape architect Mien Ruys, the pioneer of de Stijl application to garden making. Her gardens boast crisp geometries of hard and softscape elements, and we see in the right of this sketch her framing of the botanically rambunctious canal. The Tuinen and Mien Ruys are, in some respects, the Dutch landscape in microcosm. Ruys also played a role in the planning of one of the largest Dutch land reclamation projects, the Noordoostpolder of 1962, thanks to the Afsluitdijk, carved a 230 square mile track from the IJsselmeer, carefully plotted out with the same crisp lines found in the Tuinen and Mien Ruys. Standard farmhouses are simply de Stijl paintings given volume, and the staccato lines of trees chunk the polder into rectangular plots of land, as you can see in the bottom right. The top sketch is taken from Nájera, the plantar of the Nordos boulder, where Royce and other modernist designers used a style to frame the experiences of the residents. Southeast of Nájera, in the Flavel Polder, the land artist Robert Morris formed Observatory, a piece that, like other land art, draws connections between life on the ground and the cosmos. I arrived the day after the summer solstice, and rose at dawn to scrutinize the rich sequences of species in this earthwork. The Beemster is the finest example of landscape framing that I witnessed during my time in the Netherlands. A polder, the Beemster is circled by a river some 15 feet higher in elevation. Double rows of elms crown this ring, and when I arrive late in the evening, the sun had set their silhouettes aglow. Strong in geometry, there is nonetheless a diversity of tree types, of houses, and of spaces in which people can work and play. The polder was plotted out in the 17th century as, according to the ratios of the Vitruvian Man, and has since become a protected UNESCO World Heritage Site. The Beemster, in terms of visual delivery, is a masterpiece. As adaptations are made to the Dutch landscape, the machine will change, and so too will components like the Beemster, the polders, the dikes, the windmills. The Dutch have a tremendous opportunity to rethink their landscape machine in the face of climate change, and are doing so. Not static, but dynamic, landscape machines offer a way to view the landscape that unites notions of productivity, of habitation, and of cultural beauty. As a final note, I would like to thank the Knowlton School, the Columbus Foundation, the Garden Club of America, and Professor Paula Meyerink for supporting this journey. And, as the Dutch would say, dank u wel. Thank you very much.